Good morning, students. I trust you are good and you are keeping to the simple rules of the disease. Now, today we're going to look at system mapping and documentation as the second part of this topic. We met the last time and we got to know how important documentation techniques are with regards to the design of the AIs. Now, we all know that documentation actually explains how a system works in terms of sources of data, that is, who is entering data, right? Who is processing data? And who is storing data? That is where data is stored. And then information outputs, what kind of information is being generated? And of course, the system controls. So in actual fact, we have about five aspects of documentation that we need to know. And knowing this suggests that we need to ask questions about who are the people operating the system? And what kind of activities are being undertaken by the people, and when, and where, and why, and how data are generated, how data are processed, and how data are used to generate information. So, in short, documentation actually underpins the accountant's work, especially if you are an auditor. Because this is even a requirement of the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, which says that auditors or auditing standards, right, which has been promulgated by the SOX, says that auditing standards require that independent auditors understand the automated and manual internal control systems that an organization or entity is using. So one good way for gaining this understanding, right, is to use business process models. We did business process in our last lecture, and we all know what business process is. So business process actually talks about what it's involved in a particular organization, what the organization actually does. If, for example, if you pick a manufacturing company, then the business process will comprise all the activities that are undertaken from the inbound logistics stage through to the manufacturing operations to the outbound logistics stage, right? So you can draw a system documentation, or you can even flowchart that system from the inbound logistics to the outbound logistics. So if you are an auditor, then it is important that you understand the documentation techniques that has been employed by the company. So in this case, accountants also play a key role in using documentation as system designers and auditors, because without that, then they will not be able to, if they don't have any understanding of the system, then they cannot audit. You see, so that is one of the important aspects of said documentation. So today, we are going to look at only two objectives. We're going to take you through only two objectives. That is what we call balancing. That is one of the key underlying principles of documentation, especially if you are using the data flow diagram. We know that the data flow diagram, or DFD in short, actually describes how data flows from a particular point to another point. And the data flow diagram uses four symbols, right, to indicate four activities. So the data flow diagram, we have entities, what we call entities. Take note that entities here can be internal, and it can also be external. When you talk about external entities, they do not process data. So a typical example of an external entity is the customer or your supplier who only receives data or he sends data. But when you talk about internal entity, then we are talking about the processing of data by your organization. So the DFD uses squares to denote external entities or to represent external entities. And they use bubbles, or what would they say, some round object to specify an internal entity. Then it also uses arrows, simple arrows, to show the direction of flow of data from the source to the destination. In fact, you know this already. Just as I'm just recapping. Are you okay? Then again, it uses straight horizontal lines to indicate data storage, right? And then the last one, I think I've mentioned before. Okay, so that is about DFD. And we are saying that when you are drawing the DFD, there must be consistency, you see, from one stage to another. For example, if you are drawing a DFD that captures the purchasing activities within an organization, you know that for every activity that an organization undertakes, it involves some kind of chronological processes. The process must be in some orderly manner. For example, if you want to procure an asset or you want to procure goods, you cannot just stand up and say, I need this. It has to start from somewhere. So if you are talking about, let's say, inventory management in relation to your supplies that you use to manufacture your goods, then there should be inventory management activities that will specify when an order will be placed. You see, so if that has been triggered, then there should be somebody who will prepare a purchase requisition. Then the purchase order, you see, and this must be sent to your supplier for the goods to be sent. You see, so all these activities must reflect or must be consistent in the various DFD types. In fact, the DFD, we have the general type that we call the contextual DFD, right? Contextual, which actually it presents information in a highly summarized form. It doesn't actually give much detail. But if you want further details, especially about people who work in the organization, that is, if you want to identify the entities involved in the activities, then you have to draw what you call the physical DFD. And this physical DFD is actually extracted from the contextual DFD, right? Because if you are, for example, if you are drawing a contextual DFD for, let's say, a purchasing system, then you only need to represent the supplier with a square, right? You represent your purchasing system with a bubble or a circle, right? And then you also represent your accounts payable system also with a square. So it will actually contain only one bubble. But this bubble can be split into various forms, indicating the activity. You want the entities involved, then you are splitting it if you want to draw the physical DFD. You see, so we are giving more detail. So you have moved from level 0 to level 1. You see, and then we also have the logical DFD. So here we are saying that for your data or your documentation to be consistent or to balance, then whatever information you have in each of these three different DFDs, they must be the same, they must be consistent. That is what we mean by balancing of data. So explain the concept of a balanced set of system, right? Documentation. And then we also look at how to generate different forms of system documentation. But our focus will actually be on the drawing of the DLD, right? And then we also look at some system flowcharts. Okay, so our first objective number one, explain the concept of a balanced set of system documentation. And as I've already indicated, when we say a balanced set of system documentation, all we mean is that there should be consistency, right, among the entities, among the activities, among the sources of or the input, the data input, because the data output from, let's say, the purchasing clerk will be the input to another clerk. You see? So essential criterion of system documentation here is what? Consistency. And we all know what we mean by consistency. So what do we mean by balancing? Our DLDs must show a consistent representation of the external entities. Consistent. Now let's look at this in table 7.4. You see, so as you can see in the table, on the left hand side, we have the various diagrams. This is, as I've said, in the context diagram, that is more of a summary of the activities that the organization is undertaking. So here it only represents the information about what we are interested in doing. For example, the contextual diagram for University of Ghana Kubiot, we teach, we research, we learn. It's about teaching and learning and research. You see, so here you will not see several squares which we are representing with the entities. You will see several bubbles and so on. You only see few. Then when you come to the physical DFD, then we are looking at the people, the activities that are actually performed, who is actually performing a particular activity, you see? And then the logical DFD, looking at the processes involved in the system. So here you see that there is an external entity. So you see, we have a supplier. The supplier is an external entity. The supplier doesn't process data, so it cannot be considered as what, an internal entity. That's one way of distinguishing between an external entity and what, an internal entity. So we have the requesting department, and then the supplier. You can see that in all these three diagrams, we have the requesting department, we have the supplier, we have the requesting department, we have the supplier. And then the input or data sent, what data has been sent from one, from the entity, right? So we have purchase request orders, we have purchase requisition, and then we have purchase request orders, you see? So we can see that we have consistent flow of information among all the three categories of DLD. All right, so in simple terms, all we mean here is that when we say a balanced form of system documentation, then we mean that there is consistency of flow or consistency among the entities within the diagram. For example, they said the key points to remember here, if you want to talk about balancing, is that if the diagrams are not consistent, then your system documentation is incorrect, of course. So you must have a consistent diagram. External entities must be consistent with on all DLDs, external entities. So you have the contextual DLD, you have the physical DLD, and then you have the logical DLD. There should be consistency. Data flows to and from the external entities must also be what? Consistent. So you can have flow names. As for the names, it can be changed, right, from logical to the physical. I mean, that can change. But all we are saying here is that for your data flow diagrams to balance, then they must be consistent. Okay. So that is just an aspect of system documentation, in fact, with respect to DFD diagrams. Okay, so when you come to a learning objective two, then we're going to look at how to draw or to generate different system documentation, right? There are different forms that we can generate. But here we are focused, we are looking at the DFD, as I've already mentioned, and then we are looking at system flowcharts. All right. So you know that for you to generate a system documentation, we have to go through three basic steps, right? Or we can categorize them into three major steps. Now, the first step is that you need to get what we call your narrative description. You need to prepare all the activities involved, right, that organization is undertaking. So this must be documented in what we call a narrative description. So here you are just writing. But how do you get this? You must ask certain questions, collect data from the individual. So the key questions to ask when preparing system documentation: who are involved in the system? You need to know, right? What kind of activities are being undertaken by the system? What kind of data is being generated? And where is the data being sent from to, the sources of the data and the destination of the data and so on? You need to know all this. All right. So let's look at the first question. Now, so now that is the first stage anyway. That's the first major stage, the narrative description. Then you are using your narrative description to generate what you call the system mapping. How each of these activities maps onto the other, and so on. We'll look at that. Then after the mapping, you then generate your DFD. So first of all, you must generate the contextual DFD, which actually it doesn't give much detail about the system, right? So the contextual DFD just gives an overview, or it gives a broad summary of what the organization does. Then out of the contextual DFD, you can then generate your physical DFD, right? We'll get to know what is, how it is done. And then out of your physical DFD, or still from your conceptual DFD, you can generate your logical DFD. So let's go through now. Let's look at the questions to ask. Now, who are the people and things performing the activities in the process of interest? For example, here, who are the people undertaking our educational activities? We have faculty members, you have lecturers, you have students, you have other non-teaching staff, and a whole category. You have the security personnel, you have cleaners, and so on and so forth, you see? So if, for example, you want to generate a system documentation for this school, then these are the things you need to be looking at. Who are the people and things performing the activities in the process of interest, really? So now, look, this is about identifying the entities, you see? So an entity, as I've already mentioned, and we know this from our previous lecture, that entity is normally represented in the system, the DFD, right? It can be a customer, it can be a supplier, it can be an organization such as a bank. It can be anything. So we need to identify these things within our organization. So this is about identifying the entities involved in the process. And then also looking for specific people or things involved in the process. So that is the first stage. So when you have identified that, oh, this information is, or this data is generated by this and is sent to this and so on and so forth. Then the second aspect is that we need to know the activities that are being undertaken in the organization. So what activities are being performed in the process of interest, right? So I said that the process of interest is what the organization has been mandated to undertake. You see, irrespective of whether it is a profit-making or non-profit-making, a service or a discrete parts manufacturing company. Okay, but I'm using manufacturing company as an example because it is the type of company that we can see all the activities involved. All right, so this is about identifying the activities involved in the process. For example, if you pick a manufacturing company, we can group all the activities into three main stages. So we have the inbound logistics, and all these is what we describe as the value chain. So inbound logistics, where we procure raw materials that is going to be processed into the finished product, right? So here it will be dealing with the purchasing aspect. So we can draw a DFD diagram only for the purchasing aspect of the inbound logistics. We order for goods, we take delivery of the goods, we store the goods in the warehouse and so on. So there are external entities and there are internal entities in that aspect. Then we also have what? The manufacturing operations. So that is where goods are what? Converted into finished products, you see? And then we have the outbound logistics. So in simple terms, we say for a manufacturing company, you say you have your suppliers upstream, you have your customers downstream, you see, and then you, the company, you are in the middle. So these are the activities that are undertaken by a manufacturing firm. So if you can identify that, you see, you identify all these, and this can be a very huge, you know, form of information that you are gathering. Now, focus here is on the entities, that is what the entities are doing, of course. So in the process, you see, one key area or one tip that you can rely on is to know the verb. You see, that is, we say that, let's say we are processing data, or we are placing an order, or we are dispatching goods, or we are shipping goods to a customer. You see, so that will tell you that this is what is being done actually. So focus here is on the entities. Focus here on what the entities are doing in the process. You see, so focus on verbs in the process narrative. For example, we said preparing an invoice. Yes, so prepare is a voice. It's a verb, right? So you are preparing an invoice. So that will tell you that these are the activities. Or approving a transaction or event. Okay. So the second stage, we identify the activity. The third stage, then we need to know the input. What kind of data goes into the activity? And what kind of information or data comes out of each activity? So what are the inputs and the output for activity in the process of interest? So this is about drilling down. So having identified that, let's say an activity involves placing of an order. So you want to know what kind of order is being placed. You see, what materials are involved, the cost of the material, the quantities involved and so on and so forth. So drilling down into the activities to identify the inputs used and the outputs produced by the entity. See, so if it's about, let's say, a customer. So the customer is giving you an input But from his point, it's an output, right? So an input in the form of placing an order. So the order will be processed. It goes through your system. And you should know that it's your system that will process the data. As for the customer, he's an external entity. So he has only provided data. So you are going to process the data to generate an output. So you ask, where does the data come from? So you see, as I was saying, is it from a document or is it from a computer file? Then you also ask, what outputs are generated? You see, where are they saved to? So as I said, you're talking about data sources. You are talking about data processing. You are talking about data storage. You are talking about information generation, you see, and the system controls. So that is what we are looking at. So where are the data stored? And then are they in the documents or computer or whatever? You need to ask them. So that would be the test stage. Now, after the test stage, then we need to be complete because we have gone through three stages. And we can use these three stages to start the narrative table, right? So we have, in fact, prepared our narrative description. So first we have identified the entities involved in the process of interest. We have identified them. Then we have also identified the activities that is being undertaken by these entities, you see? And then we have also known the data that goes in and what is expected to come out. So we can then prepare our narrative table. Now, we make a list of the entities involved in the process. You see, so in the narrative table, for example, if you have a table, in your first column will be the entities. So you can prepare a narrative table for a sales system alone, just a sales system. So in your first, the first entity will be your sales office, where you are receiving sales orders and processing sales orders. Then you have what we call a warehouse clerk, or you have you have several officers, somebody who approve the purchasing request. You have to check for the customer's credit worthiness, you see. And even you have to check for whether what the customer is requesting is available, inventory, whether you have some in stock, and so on. You see, so this will be performed based on the company's control measures, you see, in terms of segregation of duties. All right, so you then make a list of all these entities. You see, then you have where the goods will be shipped to the customer. And you see, in every system, that is a selling system, there are activities that must follow in order and it must be approved. You see, so for example, if you place an order, then it must go to an approver if you want to buy on credit. You see, there should be somebody who will approve and so on. So when you have made all these lists, then your external entity or internal entity, you ask whether what you have stated there, you see, is an external entity or internal. This is because you need to separate your entities with horizontal lines. Now, the lines must be a solid. Either it's a solid line or it's a broken line, depending on whether is an external entity or is an internal entity. And even with the broken line, it has to go to where you have several entities, but some are sub-entities. Mm-hmm. Some are just, they are within the same section or department. Okay, so the key here is you ask questions whether the entity process data. I think I've already mentioned it. So if the entity does not process data, then it is an external entity. because it's only your entities within your organization that process the data. Of course, it's not your supplier who processes your data. It's not your customer who processes your data. You understand? So that is in line. So if it's yes, then it is what? An internal entity. All right. So external entities only receive and send data. Okay, as we have already mentioned. So your supplier only receive your, when you have sent your purchase requisition to your supplier, he only receive that data. And then you act based on what you have sent. He also send you data in the form of invoice for you to pay your accounts. You see? So you have to specify the inputs and the outputs connected to each activity. So that will be your first column. You specify all the activities. We'll see an example soon. Okay, so this is the narrative table, right? You can see that in the first column, we have all the activities, all the entities labeled in the first column. So the sales office. So this one, you can see that this is a narrative table concerning a company's sales system. A company's sales system. We can also draw a narrative table for a purchasing system. And I think that would be your assignment. I would like you to prepare first a narrative description. You just take a normal purchasing system, right? A profit-oriented organization, in actual fact. And then we also assume that the company sells on credit. Are you okay? So when you are preparing the purchasing system, then you are considering your organization as the purchaser. Are you okay? So you do that, and then you prepare a narrative table, and then you draw the various DFDs. In fact, the three types of DFDs, the contextual DFD, the physical DFD, and the logical DFD. So that will be your assignment. Okay, so here we can see that we have the sales office, and then we have the warehouse clerk. You see? So the warehouse clerk appears how many times? Four times, because there are various activities that must be undertaken. So here you can see that we may have sub entities which must be separated with dotted lines. And then we have the dispatch administrator, you see? So somebody who must dispatch the, who must administer the dispatching of goods to customers. And then we have the that one also appears twice. And finally, we have the computer. So we have four entities, right? The only one that is external is the sales office. All the others are internal. The computer will actually process the data. Then the activities involved, so process or activity. You see, so the sales office will then send sales data or sales order, data about sales order to the warehouse. And what will come out will be the sales order. You see, so this sales order will come as an input to the warehouse clerk. You see, so he is now preparing what? Packing slip. You prepare packing slip and the inputs required, as I've already mentioned, the sales order, because he has received order from the sales office that somebody is purchasing this and that. So that must be processed. So he has received the sales order. And then he will also send the output as well, the packing slip. And you know what a packing slip is? In fact, if you go through all the sales activities, we have various terminologies associated with the selling process, right? Packing slip is actually what is ordering the warehouse people to pack the goods that has been purchased to be shipped to the customer. So it's a document actually that specifies the goods that has been purchased that must be what packed. So the packing slip will also be an input to another clerk who is also in the warehouse. We have about four clerks in the warehouse, you see. So he also generates what we call posted goods, right? And this thing is too small, so I cannot. But in actual fact, this is how the narrative table is generated. Now, You have gone through the narrative description, and then you have gone through the narrative table. So we will now draw the system documentation. That is, we complete the process map. And that is where we are now going to draw the process map. So you are going to use the process narrative as the basis for process map. And that is how it is done, right? What you have presented here in the table will now be used as the basis for the process map. Now we can have a more complex process for developing a process map. Outline is 7.12. We'll come to that. But our focus here actually is on the overview of the four key stages. There are four key stages in drawing the table, that is a process map. So first, you need to gather data, and that is where you have knowledge about whatever you want to do, right? You need to gather knowledge, even from existing system documentation. You need to get that knowledge, a thorough knowledge about whatever you want to do. And then you also have to structure the map. So you draft the process map, and then you prepare based on interviews with the process experts. You see, then you map documentation, and then there will be feedback interaction. That is, you are going to ask people. People will be giving you their point, their view as to how the whole system is. Okay. So let's look at the first stage. Now, we have stages in drawing the process map. So first, you have to identify the entities and divisions. And this must be presented, because if you are drawing and you are preparing a documentation for, let's say, a sales system. In fact, this example is about sales. So they must be, the entities must be in chronological order. You see, the external entity is the one who is placing the order. So that must come first. If an order is not placed, it's just like knowing this procedure or the steps that is followed, right? The stages in the sales process. And these stages are in orderly manner. So first, somebody must place an order. And you know, in daily life, if you want to buy something, you must specify that I want to buy this item, right? Before the item will be issued to you and you make payment. It's exactly the same. So that comes first. There's no way you have your order being coming after some activity has already happened. No, it doesn't happen that way. So in chronological list of the entities and their respective activities in the process. You see, so the customer is an external entity. What is his activity? He is placing an order. You see, then keep in mind that data processing means using or transforming information. Okay, so we all know that if you want to process data, it's about conversion of a data or information into another form. But where you are just receiving or you are sending documents, that doesn't, amount to data processing. We should take note of that. So the first stage is that we identify the entities, and the entities will be labeled in the first column, as will be seen very soon. So when you have labeled all the entities in the first column like this, then you are going to draw your horizontal lines. You see, that is a process map. But you are using solid lines to separate entities. And you are using dashed lines to separate sub-entities. You see, so solid horizontal lines are used to delineate the entities, right? So label the lines down the left-hand side. So we do it. So this is how it is. Okay. We have the third stage before we look at the diagram. Then we have to indicate any sub functions, as I've already mentioned, any sub. So where you have two different entities working in the same division, For example, when you look at the warehouse, you see we have four of them. So all these four, they are sub. We have the warehouse as an entity, but then there are sub ones. So where you have two different entities working in the same division, you represent line this in what process map by dividing up the division with a broken horizontal line, as I've already said. So let's look at the figure. You see, so if you want to prepare your process map, this is the beginning. These are the entities, you see, in the left-hand column. So you have your sales, right? You have your warehouse clerk. You see, you have your dispatch administrator. And then you have your computer and so on and so forth. So these are the entities. And then the fourth one is that all the activities must be illustrated. That is, we are using squares to indicate the entities, but we use the triangle, a triangle just like the warning triangle that is used by vehicles, to indicate a control or a caution, right? Something that we have to control, or we have to apply some control rule. Okay, so process of filling in the lanes for each entity involved, see? So when you are drawing your lines, you are now going to fill the lanes. What is this entity for? Is it an external entity? Is it an internal entity? Is it a caution that we need to take? Now, represent each task performed. You see how the tasks link up with one another. You see, and then the documents and information that flows amongst the entities. And finally, process of summarizing the major stages. Okay, so let's look at this. So these are our process map. You see that the entity there is represented by a square, and that is a sales order, where the sales office processes sales order. So that is coming from a sales, and probably you have to check. In fact, this diagram is very small, so I find it difficult to read inscriptions in it. But you can see that, in fact, there are horizontal lines that are solid, but I think it wasn't properly captured. But you can see the broken lines. So you see that because the warehouse, you see, we have first warehouse, and then we also have the dispatch administrator. Because they are all, they form the same, they are in the same department. That's why we are breaking them with the horizontal broken lines. So this one will map onto this and maps onto this. So it flows from left to right, right? So you can see that this goes and this one comes, it goes right up to the end. Okay. So when you have your narrative description, and we have then generated your process map, then we can draw the documentation based on the three aspects. So the first one is a context DM, right? So key outcomes required of a concept data flow diagram. The processes that are of interest to the company is what the context data flow diagram actually is about. So what system or process are you documenting? You see? So the system of interest, as I've mentioned, and the critical as it sets the scope for the logical and physical data. You see, so you remember that you record that from the beginning of this lecture, I indicated that if you want to get the physical DFD and the logical DFD, they must all be gotten from the context DFD. You see, so it is the based on the context DFD that we can generate the physical DFD and the logical DFD. And as I've mentioned, there is only ever has one bubble. You see, so that one it summarizes all the activities involved. So it doesn't provide much detail of the system. Okay. So for example, if you want to draw the context DFD, then we have about four steps to follow. It follows about, okay. In summary, the steps to produce the context DFD. Okay, so about three steps. You have to identify the system of interest. And that is what will be represented by the bubble. You see, so this example actually is about sales processing system. You see, so the circle, which is the bubble, will actually contain the sales processing system. Then, what is this system linked to? So you have the external entity, which is the sales system or the customer, right, who place an order. And then you also have the actual systems within the organization. So you identify the system of interest represented by a bubble, and then you identify the external entities, as I've already mentioned, see, represented by what? Rectangle. And then you identify the flow of data. So identify and draw the data flows between the system of interest and the external entities. You see, arrows must show the direction of the flow of data. We know that flow of data is represented by arrows. So let's see. So this is a context diagram. You see that in the bubble, we have the we have sales. Okay, so in this external entity, we have sales office, and data will flow from this sales office because this sales office will receive customers' order, right? And they will send this data to the pick, pack, and then ship goods. Good. So you see. The circle here actually is what the company is all about. That is the activities of interest. So pick, pack, and ship goods. And then this will go to the shipping area, right? They will also send the data to the shipping area. Now you can see that the whole thing has been numbered. So this is number one, and this is what? Number 20. So what it means is that all the other activities that will give you the detail have been omitted. You see, so this is just giving you a simplified view of the activities involved in the organization. Now, when you come to the physical DFD, then you are going to break this down into further detail and you focus on the bubble. So the bubble here, you say that you should pick and you pack and ship goods, right? This will involve several activities. You see, so that physical DFD. The physical DFD is a graphical representation of the people, places, and things involved in our system of what? Interest. So now you want to look at who is involved, right? Which places or which departments or which activities are involved, and the things that are involved in processing the sales. So the matter of expanding the bubble, you see, so you're going to expand from the contextual diagram, expand the bubble. In the context diagram, you see, so the people, places, and things involved in the process are our internal entities. as I've already mentioned, because these entities, they actually process data. So they are the internal entities. All right. So what do you see? Here too, we have about six stages. You see, when you are drawing from the physical, the contextual DMB, then you go through six stages. The first stage is that you must copy the external or contextual DMB. So copy over the external entities from the contextual DMB, rectangles. Just copy. And then you identify the internal entities and list them in order as appear in the system's operations. Right, so copy over the external entities from the contextual DMB. And then that is the rectangles. You know that the external entities are normally represented by a rectangle. So you only have to know your external entities. Then we are going to identify which internal entities are involved. You see? So identify the internal entities and list them in order as appear in the system operation. How does the system operate? We see which one must come first, which one must follow to the end. So you list them in order. And then the third stage is that you are going to draw a bubble for each internal activity. You see, so we are saying that the circle actually processes data, of course. And it's true because we are saying that if it doesn't process data, it is not an internal activity. So it's not an internal entity. So it doesn't process data. So once it processes data, then it is an internal entity. So chronological order and then number of. But you see, you need to identify and draw in the data flows between the internal and external entities. That is the data flow from which to which, you see, from which source to which destination among those internal entities. And that will be your stage four, right? So we have two more stages left. Identify and draw the data flows between the internal entities. So the first one, I think, is for the external entities. So identify and draw in the data flows between the internal and external entities. Okay. So the data flows between internal and external entities. And then you draw your data flow between only internal entities. And then you identify and draw data stores. You see, by representing this by the double horizontal lines to indicate that they are data stores. Well, so data stores and their associated data flows to and from the internal entities. So we'll see this in figure 7.1. But there's one challenge here, how to sequence the numbering. Sometimes it becomes a challenge, but let's see. So this will be the physical diagram. So you can see that the bubble in the contextual diagram has been split into four. So we have 1.0, the warehouse, 2.0, dispatch administrator, 3.0, computer, and then 4.0 is what? I can't see it properly. Okay, but when you get the slides, you look at it well. And then we have two external entities. We have the sales office, and then we have the shipping office, you see. So now, take note that this shipping office is considered as an external entity because it is a separate organization. It's just like if you purchase a vehicle from the US or any other country outside Ghana, we have the car selling company, and then we also have the shipping company. So some company, that's their basic activity. They only ship goods that has been purchased by customers. See, so that is why it is also in a square. Now, we can also see that we have various storage facilities here. See, so these are the stores. And we have the various arrows indicating where data is flowing from and where data is going to. All right. The last one is the logical. And the logical step involves 8 steps, you see, because it also has to be drawn based on the contextual diagram. So you can see that whilst the physical diagram takes 6 steps, the logical diagram takes what? 8 steps, you see? So the logical DFD is graphical representation of what the activities that occur within our system of interest. So focus only on the activities that are involved. We are only concerned with the activities. Move or sell goods or what activities are involved. Adopt a time-based approach to sequencing the process. Okay. So let's look at the stages. As I've mentioned already, it involves about 8 stages. So you have to, the same thing, you copy over the external entities from the contextual diagrams we did for the physical DFD. So it's the same approach here. And then you identify and eliminate entities in the process, because this one, we are only concerned about the processes involved, the activities involved. So we are not much interested in the entities involved, the people, the places, and that, no, we are only focusing on the activity. So you have to eliminate the entities in the process narrative that just send or receive the item, you see, so they don't process any data. Okay, then your next step is that you are going to group the remaining information processing activities based on the underlying process they perform, you see, so group them. The remaining information processing activities, right? So some activities they process. I mean, those that process information, because our key issue here is that we are processing data. So draw a bubble for each of the processing or the processes, and then number them in chronological order, just as we have this numbering in the physical diagram, right? So you number them in a chronological order. And then the fifth point is that you identify and draw in the data flow between, just as we've done for the physical DFD, between the internal processes and the external entities. You remember that in the physical DFD, we also drew for the internal and the external, right? Then you also identify and draw the data between what? Processes within the system, just as we have drawn for between the internal processes for the physical DFD. But this one, we are only drawing for the processes within the system, which we are represented with bubbles. And then we identify and draw any data stores. Just as we also did for the physical, we do the same here, data stores and the associated data flows to and from the internal. Right, and then we ensure the logical flow. So ensure your logical data flow diagram balances. You remember balancing, all right, consistency. Okay, so this is a data, or this is a diagram for the logical DFD. So we can see that we have only 2 entities as we have in the physical flow DFD, and we have about 5 bubbles. But in the physical DFD, we have what? 4 bubbles. Now, this has been giving it as more detail, you see, about the processes involved. All right. So that is about the DFD. Now, we also look at the system flowchart. And as we all know, the system flow charts can be grouped into 3. We can group them into 3, right? We have the system flow chart. In fact, the system flow chart shows the relationship among the inputs, the processing, and the outputs, and then of an information system. So it shows the processes. But when you talk about the flowchart itself, it's also a diagrammatical a graphical description of system, right? We just describe a system in a graphical form, right? So we have a system flowchart. We have the document flowchart, which also shows the flow of documents and information between departments or areas of responsibility. And then we have the program flowchart, and that actually shows the sequence of logical operations a computer performs as it exercises a program. Okay, so we need to understand the system. If you want to flowchart a particular system and you don't have any knowledge about the system, you don't understand the system, how can you do it? So the key to flowcharting a system is the understanding of the whole system. So you need to break up the base and entities, processes, inputs and outputs, you see? By doing that, then you can get the logical flow of the processes and the data. Then you represent the entities. So listed along the top. In fact, in the last lecture, we talk about flowchart, and we know that the flowchart also uses symbols. That is different from that of the DMD, right? So I'm basing this lecture on the fact that you already know all this. You have knowledge about the flowchart, right? So if you are drawing the system flowchart, then you have to understand the system and represent the entities listed along the top, creating vertical lanes in our chart. As we can see the chart at the end of the lecture, and then you complete each entity's activity. So use of the flowchart symbols used in flowchart. All right. So drawing system documentation, the system flowchart, we provide the rules and pointers for flowchart preparation and presentation. In fact, we have referred this in figure 2.7.22 in a textbook. So you can read about it from here. You need to read thoroughly about the flowcharting. So what you are looking to end up is a flowchart, right? Like that shown in figure 7.23. Okay. So this is a typical flowchart, right? That you can draw for the computer to read. But this is a system flowchart. We have various presentations for the various types, right? This is a document flowchart. It's presented in a columnar form and so on. Okay, so read more about the flowchart from the textbook. So that brings us to the end of this lecture. In our next lecture, we'll be looking at the system controls, which is very key to the design of AIS, because without the controls, your system will be exposed to risk. You have various types of risk. You have risk that you can control and those that you cannot control. So we look at the various control measures that must be in place, right, to safeguard the system and the assets. So in this lecture, we have actually looked at the concept of a balanced set of system documentation. When we talk of a balanced set, all we mean is that the system should be consistent. There should be consistency across all the various dimensions. External entities are consistent across series of DMDs, right? And that is much what we are actually interested in. Data sources or data stores are consistent between the physical and logical, you see, as I already explained from the beginning. So you should be able to draw the different types of system documentation. Okay, so like I said, you need to draw what the example we use in this lecture is a sales system, a system documentation for sales. So do the same thing for purchases, right? Purchases. So how does purchases occur? who are the entities involved in purchases? Mm-hmm. What are the processes involved? Do identify all that. So you prepare your narrative description, and then your narrative table, and then you draw your contextual DFD, and then out of the contextual DFD, you draw your physical DFD. And then out of that, you also draw your logical DFD. All right, so that will be the end for today. We'll meet next time for the system controls. Have a good day.